Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today I will show you how to connect your VS Code to a remote server to do remote development, the concept remote development. To do that, we need to first of all install a plugin in your VS Code. You can go here in the left side to the menu, to the section extensions, and choose Remote Explorer. I will show you now, get you access to different possibilities to connect your VS Code to different kind of container servers or even other operating systems installed in your local machine. You just install it here. Again, I already have installed it. It's pretty simple. And then once you have this installed, you get here the remote explore section. So the section, the main important subsections in this plugin is the SSH. That containers which allow you to connect to containers that you had in your Docker Explorer in your local environment, and also Windows or System Linux flavors or containers that you have installed in your local machine. Now we are going to see what we need to set up a connection to a remote server. This remote server is the conventional or the typical VM that you had in Azure, in AWS or in Google. You just create the VM there in the cloud, in your cloud provider. It can be others as well, but these three main cloud providers are practically identical the configuration. You just create the VM, and then to do a remote connection or to connect to the machine via SSH, this is essentially what we are going to do: tunnel the connection from your VS Code client to the VS Code server that is going to be running on the remote server, and this is going to be done through a SSH tunnel. To connect to via SSH, you need a public key that is being created during the installation of the VM on the cloud. So you need some values from your server. You will need the IP address of this machine. You will need as well the user that you need to connect to that machine, and you will need as well the public key for the user that you created during the installation of the VM. So once you have these three values, you go to the folder that is, in my case, I'm working from a Windows machine. You have in your home directory that is under C users, the name of the user, in my case is user, the folder .ssh. There, if you don't have a file with the name config, you just need to create it, and also you need to copy in this folder or in another but under SSH the public key that you need to connect to the remote server. So you just open the file and create an entrance similar to this. In the host, you create this host entrance that is the root of the entrance. You just set up the name of the connection. Here is I'm using the same IP address, but you can put a tag or the name of the server or something that help you to identify where you are connecting. In the hostname attribute, you just write down the IP address. Identity file is the path to the public key or the credential you are going to use to connect to the server, and the user attributes is the user that you use to connect and is associated to this public key that you will use to connect to the server. I will provide you as well in the documentation of the video this link, which is the whole configuration of the plugin, and case that you have a specific configuration, you will find all the details here. For example, if you need to do port forwarding, it is quite typical case that you need to forward an application port some application that is serving in a specific IP port. If you want to connect to that port, you will need to forward these ports to introducing attributes like this to forward the local port in the server to a local port in the remote machine, or the remote machine to the local machine. That way you will be able to connect to some of the ports that are running on that machine via the said SSH tunnel. To give you an idea, and the price here completely explained how it works. You at the end you are connecting from your local machine to a remote machine at the end via SSH. No? If you are forwarding ports, remote ports to local ports via those ports, those connections, this traffic is going through the tunnel. So if you need to connect from your local machine to some of the ports in the local server, the best way is doing a port forwarding. As is configured there. Just imagine that you install, for example, a Jupyter server or a Jupyter notebook. You just will install in the server the Jupyter server and run it. And after that, you need to, if you want to connect in that connection, you just need to configure a local forward from again the port in the remote server to the port that is going to be listening in your local computer. In this case, for example, means that we had an application that is being served in the remote server in the port 27017, and you can point, once you set up the SSH connection, you can point in your local machine to this IP address, this is the local host and this port, and you will see the application that is running in the remote server. This is quite convenient, again, if you are testing, for example, a fast API application, or you are want to connect to a Jupyter notebook that is running on the remote server, you need to include the local forward sections in order to forward the ports in the remote server to your local machine. But again, I will send you, hit you as well the link on the documentation that I will later on post in the repository. You can review at your convenience, because here is everything explaining. It's just simply configuration of an SSH connection. Okay, this is one of the requirements, that you need to set up a connection, and the other one is you just go to the settings and you just SSH, I don't remember what was exactly SSH, you write SSH config file, and then you will get these settings, and here you will set up the default configuration file for the SSH remote connections. As you remember, we have it in C /user/user. In my case, is a user, my username or the username I use to connect to this local machine, and then in the folder .ssh and the file config. You close this, and then on the final setup, it's just you click new remote. Here, you obviously you will not see this server. This is the server where I already configured. You just click in new remote. You just write here SSH user @IP address. you just specify the file, case that you have multiple configuration files in multiple locations, you may want to choose, but it's not better to have all the configurations in a single location with all the remote connections that you need to connect. You specify, and as you see here, okay, you just click connect and it opens the connection to the remote machine. You just click Linux, in this case I come on. One second. Yeah, sorry, it was just a misspelling in a word. Yeah, once you select and click connect, you get the connection in the remote server. As you can see here, I had behind the VS Code that was running in my local computer, and now I had a new VS Code that is running. As you see here in the bottom left corner, you see that is connected via SSH to the IP address. If you just simply open a new terminal, you will see that are connected in a Linux box, and then if config okay, if config, and you get the machine that is the remote server. You can now, you are working in the, you are connected and working like if you were in local, but everything is happening, every change that you may do, it will happen on the remote server, not in your local machine. The only thing that is connected to the that is working in local is the client, and the client is connected again to your to the remote server. If you change something, you can open here a folder, a repository. I have here a repository. You open it. And then, well, here is connected to a repository. You can connect to a repository. You don't have access, you will need to set up the credentials to access that repository, or to you want to access a service, in this case in Azure, if you have access, you use the correct credentials, you will connect. You need to connect to a service outside via BGET or HTTP. Usually the VNs had full access via HTTP or HTTPS to the internet. This will be done, and again, you are now in the remote server, so everything that is allowed to the user that you use to connect via SSH, everything that is allowed to that user, you will be able to do it in the remote connection, either in the console or developing. Here you can now start to develop everything you need and test it. Again, you can run code, you can install a new environment and do some debugging, whatever you need, or install new packages, or replicate some code or some files to hacer with async to another folder, whatever is possible in a Linux or Unix box is possible to do it now for you. And well, basically that's all. One last question: if you see here, we don't see the same. Plugins, the same sections that we have on the local host. Yeah, that is normal. The only ones that will pass from the host to the remote server will be the mandatory ones, that are these four. and the remote connection. The other ones that you have in your local computer, if you want to install it, you will have to do it manually again on the instance or in the session that you are connecting to this remote server. And well, that's all. Thank you very much for watching, and as I said before or in my previous videos, if you like the content, just hit me a like and subscribe to the channel if you didn't do it before. Thank you very much. See you soon.